to those around you, please turn your cell phones and cameras to the opposition. Now, it's my pleasure to present to you Julius E. Erlenbaum, Chancellor of the University of Wisconsin.
Thank you very much, Provost Hardwood, and a warm welcome to all of you on yet one more, albeit breezy, but beautiful day in Superior, Wisconsin. This is truly a glorious occasion for our graduates, and it's a special pleasure to have all of you here to help them celebrate this commencement. Graduates, as you get ready to graduate and commence the next phase of your lives, it's important to remember that your experiences here are just the beginning. If you think about what it means to be educated, you will realize that becoming educated helps you know how much you really don't know. In order to ensure that you continue to expand your knowledge of yourself and your world, you must develop a commitment to lifelong learning and to your continued learning.
It's Linda Lou and Kathy and the other awesome women and men who have kept us fed over the years. It's Mike Mullen and his great staff, campus safety officers who have kept us safe. It's people like Tammy Fanning, who's always there to help with student functions and offer assistance. The Janet Blairs and other department secretaries, all the administrative assistants, librarians, and others who work behind the scenes that have ensured that we always got the support and resources we needed to be here today. Then there's this tremendous faculty. I believe there's a difference between a professor and a teacher. To me, a professor teaches you about a subject, but a teacher can teach you about life. And this university is filled with outstanding teachers. I feel so honored and blessed to have had the opportunity to learn from so many of you, the lessons of Mary Pulford, Marshall Johnson, Haji, Gary Cabellas, and so many others will remain with me always. I'll never forget Dr. Kuzo's lectures about the power of language, speaking truth to power, and other life lessons that I've learned from her and from so many of you here today. And these incredible lessons don't always come from a classroom. I was so inspired to see David Obermiller, one of my favorite professors and teachers, out in the community, and not just talking the talk, but walking the walk, and actively engaging in the lessons of activism and community involvement that he teaches about daily. You have all taken the time to get to know us, our names, our faces, and our stories. That's something my friends from bigger schools simply don't get to experience. But it makes us more successful students, and it will make us more successful people. So thank you all for the lessons, for your time, and for your impact on our lives. Speaking of heroes, I've had the constant patience, support, and understanding of a great advisor and teacher, Dr. Gloria Toivola. Dr. Toivola embodies the meaning of hero, and she has helped pave the way for all women faculty members. I say she has been contributing to this campus now for 36 years. This school and all those who have passed through the classroom are fortunate and grateful for that. You saw my transcripts from my first year of college and you decided to be my advisor anyways. I wouldn't be here today without your support, patience, and guidance, so thank you. And of course, I'm so proud of you, my fellow graduates. A few weeks ago, my wife Tara and I attended the Students of Excellence Awards. We sat towards the back of the room. We wound up sitting next to a man by himself. As they introduced John Mansell as the other recipient of the Chancellor's Leadership Award, this man, a stranger to us both, leaned over to us and with pride beaming from his face, sort of grandly said, "That's my son." It was a touching moment, and having known and worked with John over the last couple of years with student government, I can see why his father would be so proud of him. But John is only one of many students who exemplify the participation and activism we see so often on this campus. So many of you have contributed to and have represented UWS over the years through organizations, activities, athletics, and other forms of involvement. And you have made this school and your fellow classmates very proud. All of you here, from family and friends, faculty and staff, to fellow students, have made the day possible for me and for all of us. And for that, and for so much more, we are grateful, and we are prepared for our future endeavors. And that future is bright for the class of 2006. Yet, our generation is being faced with challenges the likes of which previous generations never imagined. Some members of this graduating class here today represent one of the first classes to begin and end their college education in a post-9/11 world. As we all know, the world was changed that day. Furthermore, the faces of the college students themselves are ever-changing, and that is clearly represented every day. The lines between traditional and non-traditional students are increasingly blurred, with more and more students coming back for a degree later in life, or for those choosing that are having to postpone school for any number of reasons, such as military, financial, or family matters. Also, many of you here today have come from diverse backgrounds. Some of you can travel over vast oceans to be here and to receive this quality education. And UWS has an extraordinary diversity program. I never would have imagined that I'd come here to this far northwestern corner of Wisconsin to be friends with people from all over the world. From Sri Lanka to Japan, to England, Venezuela to the Bahamas, all throughout Africa and other parts of Europe. Some of you have traveled there and you have enriched our education and our life. So thank you for making that journey and for making our journey that much better. Because of this new and changing phase of the college student, many of you have already been faced with challenges and obstacles. For example, I know those of us who have returned from combat recently are dealing with issues like anxiety and other transitional issues. This is an increasing problem the more we talk to faculty and staff and hear about it, with more and more men and women returning from war. And it's also important to remember that there are still over 100,000 brave men and women in harm's way in Iraq and Afghanistan. Mostly our college days, just like us. But the experience in Iraq also afforded me the opportunity to meet amazing people from all corners of the world. I was fortunate enough not only to see death and destruction, but also the absolute best of humankind. I saw true beauty and cooperation among people who speak different languages and believe in different gods, but who are working together to build a better future for our upcoming generation. That is the kind of cooperation and inspiration that can and will change the world. But for further inspiration, we didn't look any farther than our own country. As we speak here today, this May 20th, thousands of residents of New Orleans are once again heading to the election booth in an attempt to rebuild their community. The devastation that occurred can only partly be blamed on nature. Serious flaws within our political and social systems were uncovered, yet these brave survivors who have weathered the storm now see the same things that the Iraqis saw last year when they risked their lives to head to the election booth. We are all seeking the same result. Peace, equality, freedom from oppression, and a better world for us and future generations. But aside from global warfare, the world around us is also struggling with major issues such as global poverty, inopportunity, and injustice, such as the genocide that continues to occur in Sudan, even with human intervention. The rising cost of healthcare and education, we have environmental issues such as global warming, we have an AIDS epidemic and other health issues. Within our own community, we must work to combat continued and persistent prejudice in the form of racism.
In your income, over the course of a lifetime, you will earn an average of over $1 million more than a high school graduate. And for those of you who go on to graduate school or a professional degree, you can double that difference. Of course, you're from UW Security, and being the analytical person that a good liberal arts education has trained you to be, you might point out that it cost you a lot of money to get this education. And you might observe that you gave up the opportunity to make money while you were here pursuing your education. So is this bachelor's degree still a good investment? Yes, it is. The economists tell us that the rate of return on the benefits to an individual of a college education is a little over 12%. That compares very favorably to the 7% historical rate of return on stocks over the last 100 years. So that's some pretty good news for you as an individual. I would like to suggest, however, that we have placed too much emphasis on the benefits of education to the individual. During the 20th century, Americans came to believe that the public at large benefits most from an educated citizenry. The prevailing sentiment in America was that education produced a more engaged citizenry. Most people also agreed that the public at large benefits from the economic and the social development stimulated by the creativity
the productivity resulting from university research. These were the reasons that your parents, your grandparents, and your great-grandparents were willing to support a system of public higher education that became the envy of the world. They were willing to have their taxes pay over one half of the cost of a college education, with students and their families picking up the difference in tuition. Somewhere along the line, we lost sight of that vision. We citizens ourselves allowed a new argument to prevail in the funding of higher education. This new argument said that you, the students, and your families should pay the larger portion of the cost of a college education because you, as individuals, were going to get the benefits through increased lifetime earnings and through a longer, more healthier, a healthier, more productive life. This new argument allowed lawmakers, it gave them a rationale for shifting the burden of paying for higher education from the state and local, state and national governments to students and their families. You have witnessed this shift in your few short years on this campus, but this has been going on for the last 35 years. In the 70s, state government contributed almost one half of the cost of higher education. Bit by bit, votes by Democrats and Republicans alike has decreased that support so that now it is just a little over 25%. And you know all too well, and your families know all too well, what makes up the difference. It's tuition. It's the only other source of revenue that we have to provide for teaching students. Higher income families have been able to absorb these tuition increases with some sacrifice. But what about the other families? What has this new argument done for them? Edward St. John, a noted education expert, says that during the 1990s alone, rising tuition costs and inadequate student financial aid prevented more than 1 million otherwise qualified low-income students from continuing their education past high school. In my opinion, this is a national disgrace. Everyone here this afternoon knows talent, creativity, drive are not the exclusive purview of wealthy families. Children with the gifts of creativity and intellect are born in the families of all income levels. By allowing this new argument to prevail, or I would say, by not adhering to the foresight, the wisdom, and the ideals of our forebears, we have seriously compromised one of our most valuable public assets. It is the thing that historically has given us the edge in this country, and that is our public higher education system. Now, can we in Wisconsin take comfort that this kind of a problem is being experienced in states all throughout the country? No, we cannot. And if you want to know why, read Tom Friedman's book, The World is Flat. Higher education investments are exploding in countries such as China, India, Chile, countries that will present you, the graduates, and the businesses you work for, or the businesses that you create, with the fiercest economic competition ever faced by any group of American workers in our history. We in Wisconsin need to recognize, and citizens in every state throughout the country need to recognize, that the rest of the world is catching up. Smart, creative children are born every day all over the world, and increasingly They are educated in their own countries, and that education is getting better. As Tom Friedman points out, those graduates are not racing us to the bottom. They are racing us to the top. Examples. The United States used to be first in terms of college attendance. We have now fallen to sixth. Research and development investments by other countries are increasing well above the levels in the United States. As a result, the United States percentage of the total world output of goods and services has fallen from 40 to 21%. And here's an eye-opener for those of you who intend to go on to graduate school. The United States used to produce 61% of all published research. But as other countries have exercised new levels of research leadership, it now produces only 29%. Finally, and perhaps the most telling signal that the world is catching up to us, is that only 52% of the patents responsible for American industrial leadership are now owned by U.S. sources, the lowest percentage in our history. Over the next 5 years, these numbers will increase exponentially as highly populated countries in Asia, South America, and Europe dramatically increase the percentage of their population enrolled in higher education. Added to this is the fact that most of the countries have significantly younger populations than we do in the United States. Their ability to mobilize large, well-educated workforces will make them significant economic forces for years to come. So, members of the class of 2006, you'll be in the middle of this fierce economic competition. You'll be engaged in your communities, and you will then be able to confront politicians with your votes. All I ask is that you examine the new argument for yourselves. Examine the new arguments for your children. Is public higher education about granting economic opportunities to the individual? Or is public higher education about the social, cultural, political, and economic well-being of our nation? I submit that the level of state support that we demand and that we are willing to pay for is a public policy question, a vital question facing us today. And now, I'm happy to say, all of you are part of us. We welcome you for sharing the responsibility for making these tough policy questions. As I look at the depth and breadth of your undergraduate curriculum on this campus, and as I read about your remarkable undergraduate research, and as I learn about your idealism and your ample good works, I'm optimistic for our state, our nation, and our world. Congratulations. Are you ready to graduate? Are you ready to graduate? At this time, it is my honor to present the candidates for degrees. Will the candidates receiving the associate degree please rise? I am pleased also to introduce Mr. John Munson, who will announce the candidates. Chancellor Uma, on behalf of the faculty, I am pleased to present the candidates for the associate degree.
By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Regents of the University of Wisconsin System, and upon the recommendation of the faculty of the University of Wisconsin Superior, but subject to the successful completion of any and all remaining requirements, I confer upon each of you the associate degree for which you have been recommended with all of the rights, privileges, and responsibilities thereunto appertaining. I would ask that the marshals please bring the candidates forward, and that Registrar Barb Erickson would please assist me in the awarding of these degrees. By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Regents of the University,
Twyla Don Montagna. Rebecca Ray Morrison, summa cum laude. Yoshikuni Ogata. Catherine Jeanette Schaefer. Shelley Louise Tuttle, magna cum laude. Nicholas W. Vassell. Rebecca A. Wetter. James Owen Clark. Lacey Francovia. Rebecca D. Franz. Jessica N. Gast, magna cum laude. Chad Lee Hartwig. Matthew George Jones. Samantha Prager. Marianne E. Robertson. Jason Ronald Minky, magna cum laude. Megan Nicole Elm, magna cum laude. Eric Scott Lundberg. Alexa Genevieve Sorensen, cum laude. Eric Henry Abrahamson. Mariah A. Ackerman. Pamela Addy. Taylor Joseph Alborg. Shonu Ray Albertus. Caitlin Elizabeth Anderson, magna cum laude. Diane M. Anderson, summa cum laude, University Honors Program graduate.
Family, friends, faculty, and staff, I present to you the graduating class of 2006. As we close today's ceremony, I ask that you remain in your seats.